Just while some others are gathering in, we're going to sing a few hymns together. Just keeping our seats, we'll start off with 474, 474 days are filled with sorrow and care. We still have some empty seats at the front, and they're just as cheap as the seats at the back, so don't be afraid to come away up to the front. 474, and we'll sing the first two verses, remaining seated. Amen. 228, 228. I have a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. The message unto you I'll give. It is recorded in his word. Hallelujah. It is only that you look and live. The first two verses, let's try and raise the volume that bit as we sing together. Oh, how sweet the glorious message simple faith may claim. Yesterday, today, forever, Jesus is the same. Verses 1 and 2, it's number 90 if you're using the hymn book.
Thank you.
looking for seats, there's still three or four seats here at the front. If anyone wants to use them, just come right up to the front. Okay, verse 2, he who was the friend of sinners. Four, 224, great gospel hymn. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? 224, remaining seated. Singing well already this evening, but we come now to our opening hymn for the meeting tonight, and it's 483. There's a Saviour from all sin. If you only let him in to your heart, he there will reign while you trust him. 483, we're going to stand this time, and let's really sing it out. Let's praise the Lord together.
Thank you.
Let us now bow together in prayer. We'll just still our hearts as we come into the Lord's presence, and we ask God for his blessing and to look upon us tonight in favour. Our Heavenly Father and our gracious God, we do thank thee that as we bow together, that we can be still and know that thou art God. And we rejoice tonight, our Father, in all of thy loving kindness. And we thank thee for every tender mercy that thou dost so graciously bestow upon us each and every day. We would say tonight, blessed be the Lord, who daily loadeth us with benefits. And we thank thee, our Father, for the great love wherewith thou hast loved us. And we do thank thee, our Father, tonight for every redeemed and every blood-bought soul, for those that have been born again of the Holy Spirit of God. And thy word declares, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven and whose sin is covered. And we want to thank thee tonight, our Father, for thy forgiveness. We thank thee, O God, for thy pardon and even for the cleansing and the covering of the Saviour's precious blood. And we rejoice tonight in the finished work of Calvary, that even as our Lord and Saviour suffered in agony and in blood as he laid down his life at Golgotha's hillside, we do thank thee that he was able to cry from the cross, "It is finished." And we thank thee tonight, our Father, that the price of our salvation has been paid in full, and that we can come by faith to rest upon the finished work of Christ. And being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And tonight, our Father, we pray that the hearts of thy children would be filled with thankfulness and with praise. And, O Lord, that thou wouldst give to us even that prayer of faith just now. And thou would give to us, O God, that greater burden to see those who are lost and dying in sin gloriously and wonderfully converted to Christ. And yet, O God, we know of ourselves, we are not able, we are not sufficient for this work. But we thank thee for the power, the regenerating power of God the Holy Spirit. And we pray, our Father, that even now thou wouldst move upon hearts, we pray, and that this night, our Father, there may be precious souls, the saved of the Lord, those who would avail of the opportunity in this day of grace to close in with thine offer of mercy. We believe, our Father, there are those that have heard thy precious word and remain unconverted. And we pray that tonight thou would search them out in this gospel meeting. Turn, O God, the searchlight of thy precious word upon their heart tonight. And we pray for the convicting power of God the Holy Spirit. And be pleased tonight to draw sinners to the Lord Jesus Christ. Hear, O God, and answer prayer. And receive of our thanks that we're here tonight. We're not out in the world, O God. We're not chasing after the broken cisterns. We thank thee, our Father, that we have come to the one who is able to satisfy the longing soul and able to fill the hungry soul with goodness. Lord, bless tonight each one that will take part. We thank thee for the Kingdom Heirs that have come to minister in song. We praise thee, O God, for their service for thee down through many years. And even tonight, O God, use them to thine honor and to thy glory. And we thank thee, our Father, for thy servant who has come to testify tonight. And we praise thee, O God, for ever saving his soul, even in this corner. And we pray that thou wouldst give him help from heaven tonight and bless him in his own soul and make him a blessing to each one that is gathered here. And what thou hast done for him, O Lord, we would pray reverently tonight. Do it again, we pray. Down through the years, so many souls that have been saved as a result of the work and the witness here. Lord, move again in power to the honor and to the glory of our Lord and Savior. We ask these things in his great name. Amen. Amen. We do give a very warm welcome tonight to the Kingdom Heirs, and we're glad that they have come along to take part in our gospel mission. We'll ask them to bring their first two messages in song now, please. Thank you.
Thank you.
Amen. We do thank the Kingdom Heirs for those messages and song, and may the Lord bless them to each one of our hearts this evening. I want to give everyone a warm welcome to the final weeknight of our gospel mission, and we're glad to see a good turnout tonight and the hall well filled. If you're visiting with us, you're especially welcome, and I just want to say a word of thanks to all of the visitors who have supported our gospel mission over the past couple of weeks. I can thank our own people on the Lord's Day, but I want to thank you this evening for coming out to support the mission. I also see the Reverend and Mrs. Barnes and the Reverend Mrs. Greenfield in the meeting as well, and we do thank you for being here tonight, and we trust that you're made to feel warmly welcome as you visit with us. Now, there's supper for everyone tonight. Well, I say that, but with such a good turnout, we've burgers. So I hope we've enough burgers to go round. So the secret is, get up to the table first. They're going to be lined right along the front here, a table for each side. And so if you come up last, don't be blaming me that there's none left. I've told you, get up early and get up first. And we thank those who have helped with the preparation of the supper. And then the mission finishes on this Lord's Day evening. The meeting is at 7 p.m. The Reverend John Morrow is the preacher, and Miss Cherith Kenny will be ministering in song. Now, we're all going to sing another hymn together just before the Kingdom Heirs come again to minister to us. 587, from the book, Shall We Gather at the River, where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing from the throne of God. We'll stand as we praise the Lord with this hymn. Amen. I do want to give a very warm welcome this evening to the Reverend David Wilson. And we've been inviting different individuals to take part in our mission who have had some connection with the work here over the past number of years. And our brother was saved through the work and the witness here in Hillsborough. And so we've invited him along tonight to testify, and as he testifies, also to apply the gospel. And we trust that our brother will know the help of the Lord. But the Kingdom Heirs are going to sing for us again. I keep them going that I'm the substitute. If any of them gets a sore throat, I'm ready on the wings. So I got my navy suit and, and my blue shirt and my grey hair, and I'm ready. If they need me, I'm here. Okay.
For that, you'll have to turn off airplane mode.
Amazing grace, how sweet. Good evening, everyone. It is a delight for me to be here tonight. I really appreciate the invitation. This is a special place for me, and it's lovely to see familiar faces, people that knew me when I was here as a young convert, and people who have helped me in my walk with God, and people who have put me on an arm lock on the door on the way out, like Norman McCready, and nearly taken me to Papua New Guinea with him. It's nice to see Andrew and Mark, and memories of those young days. 34 years ago, nearly 35, February next year, I was converted in this hall. And it doesn't look as if it's changed much. I don't remember this very tight pulpit. Seems to restrict my liberties, but I'm very grateful. I am very grateful for the invitation to be here tonight. Appreciate those songs with all the constant theme there, obviously, of salvation. It was Joe Peden who took that mission that I was converted in. That was the time he was producing his album, Oh, Saved, and I'm Glad. You glad you're saved tonight? I hope you are saved. And if you're not, I hope you walk out like I did on that Tuesday, 20th of February, 1990, knowing. Came in not knowing, but I went out knowing. I'd like to read with you, please, if you have a copy of the scriptures, Romans chapter 10, verses 1 to 13. Romans chapter 10, verses 1 to 13, please. Apostle Paul's letter to the church at Rome, chapter 10. And you'll allow me, please, to just make a few comments as I read from 1 to 13. Brethren, the word of God says, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Israel, the people who had the word, the people who had the privileges. That's who I was. And maybe there's someone here tonight, and that's who you are. You're part of that privileged people who've been brought up in the house of God, knowing the scriptures from childhood, but not saved. Paul prays earnestly that those of his day in that situation would know the experience of salvation. And he says in verse 2, for I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. I'm sure you've heard something of Luther in the few days that have gone by. Yesterday, Reformation Day. Romans 1, the same book, chapter 1, verse 17. That great time of enlightenment for Luther. He realized that the righteousness of God could not be earned, that he could not make himself attractive to God, but that God's love for him and the righteousness that God provided was what was going to make him attractive. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. We watched the Reformation film, Luther, the 1950s Lutheran church production, Wednesday night in Ballyclare. And there's that great scene where the leader of the monastery, the Augustinian monastery, says to Luther, if you get rid of the relics and if you get rid of the idols and if you get rid of all these supports, what will you replace it with? And Luther says, Christ. The sinner only needs Christ. Verse 5, for Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which doeth those things shall live by them. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise, say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith, which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there's no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. May this word come with authoritative power from the Lord's Spirit himself to your heart this night. Can we pray briefly? Lord, we take the words that you gave to Joshua, as I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. We glory in infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon us. May you, Lord God, Lord Jesus Christ, Savior of sinners, may you be seen clearly tonight. May you be uplifted and magnified before the people. And as you are, may you fulfill your promise to draw men and women, young people, to thyself. Thank you for your grace which is undeserved, your grace which saves from the guttermost to the uttermost. O Lord, grant us your aid and grant us your blessing. Do thy sovereign will, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm looking at people who have given testimony before. I trust if your pastor asked you to give testimony, you could, because you have a testimony of saving faith. But when I give testimony, there's always a tension in my heart. And that's for a various number of reasons. Number one, I suppose, because there's a potential to mislead you all into thinking, especially if you're not someone familiar with testimonies, perhaps you're just a visitor here tonight, I don't know you all, but there is that potential that I would mislead you and somehow, as it were, get across to you that my experience of salvation is definitive, that unless you come the way I came with all of the emotions and all of the journey that I came on, that somehow you can't be saved. Well, of course, that's not true. Many roads lead to the cross. No one gets to glory. No one gets God's salvation without coming via the cross. And what do I mean by that? I simply mean that what took place there on that cross, that perfectly sinless God-man doing what you couldn't do and taking the punishment that you couldn't take in an eternity, believing that that was your death, was your sacrifice. That's the only way of salvation. But how you come to that place, isn't it wonderful? And I'm encouraged, of course, as I read my Bible and I find the Apostle Paul. What did he do? What did he do when he was faced with new people, when he was faced with unexpected circumstances? He just gave his testimony. He just talked about his experience of God. And so I'm encouraged that by me expressing to you what God has done in my life, God can use that. And I pray that he does. And then there's always that sense of vulnerability when you testify. Telling people things, innermost thoughts, things that troubled you and bothered you. And certainly, we don't want to give the impression that we're on the road of faith 34 years and we've got it all sorted. Got it all worked out. Everything's going smooth. No, a testimony has to be up to date. And I certainly wouldn't want to give anybody that impression. And then I suppose there's the tension, because I know there's always a temptation in my heart to present an embellished image of myself. Color the facts, distort the reality. I wonder, do you realize the first time the question in the Bible is asked, who are you? It's in Genesis 27, and the answer is a lie. Jacob says, I'm Esau. So I trust that what you get tonight is the raw truth, and that the Lord will bless you through it. Now, I have three basic points, and the first one is exactly those words that I've quoted in that question. Who am I? Who am I? Something I began to ask myself. Now, if you were one of my neighbors, you might answer that question, oh, he's the guy that drives the red transit van. It's parked outside. I still drive it and use it for the church. Praise the Lord. They might say, oh, he's the fellow that's married to Anne the nurse. He's the one with the big family. Might say, oh yeah, he's the fellow that worked in the Christian schools. Some of you know that I did that and still do, actually, one day a week. Can't get away from it, but I do love the work. If you're about the Clocker Valley area, where I lived for the last 18 years before moving to Ballyclare, well, they might just know me as Philip's dad, because I just watched my son play rugby there for the club, and I just would have been Philip's dad. If you're part of my mum's generation, and some of you know my mum, and thank you for asking about my mum tonight. Some of you have even seen me already and had a quick chat. My mum, well, her generation would just know me as Mona's son. He's Mona's son. Or my sister's generation, my big sister. Oh, he's Ruth's wee brother. If you knew me in my school days, as I happened to meet somebody on the plane on the way home from Spain the other day, found out that she went to school with me. Oh, you're the guy that I went to school with. And if you were in Spain, my oldest daughter Emma lives in Spain now, and they just call me, oh, it's Emma's dad. Go and see Emma's dad. And I suppose if you asked anybody in Ballyclare, who is that man? They'd say, oh, he's the new preacher in town. But all of these are just identity labels, aren't they? Based on external information and a perspective that others have of me. And many of you know the verse in the Bible in 1 Samuel chapter 16, which says, man looketh on the outward appearance. And that's not necessarily a negative comment. That's just God saying, that's the way it is. That's all we can see, and we have to make our judgments based on the outside. And thank God, if you're saved and God's done a work in your heart, then by God's grace and transforming power, what's happened on the inside begins to work its way out on the outside. Hallelujah. But some of you know how that verse goes on. God looks on the heart. If you want to know who I really am, if I want to know, and I did when I was 16, who I really was, if you want to know who you really are, then that is only revealed in the heart. The Lord looketh on the heart. Man looks on the outward appearance, the verse says, but God can see the heart. And what I am on the inside, my true character and nature, that's the real me, that's the real you. Now, if God is the only one who can see that heart, and he is, remember Jeremiah 17? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? And the answer to the question is, I, the Lord. Who can know your heart? Who can really know the real you? Who can really answer that question? The Bible says, men and women and young people here tonight, that you can't even answer that question properly. And yet that was a question I desperately wanted the answer to at the age of 16. Who am I? Who are you? God alone, the Bible says, knows. And at the age of about 18 or 19, I began to take an interest in my family tree. And I went down to the public records office, as you had to do in those days, no Google, no internet, down in Chichester Street. And I began to search through the records, getting directed to the right area. And to my dismay, on finding the record of myself and the card with my name on it and my birth details, I discovered that I was not who I thought I was, because for 18 to 19 years, I believed I was David Samuel Wilson. It's on my bank accounts, on the correspondence that was sent to our house. It was on my new bank card that I was so proud of at the age of 18. And on the card, it said David Wilson. I went up to the clerk. I said, sorry, excuse me, there must be a mistake. I'm David Samuel Wilson. You forgot my middle name. Oh, no, she said, that record's accurate. It's a long story, but a sort of mini identity crisis began to develop. I went home and checked my birth certificate, and lo and behold, written in black ink, as it was in those days, and then a little arrow in between David and Wilson, and in blue fountain pen, Samuel. My mum had put it in afterwards. And I had thought all along, in fact, it's still on my bank card to this day, but I wasn't who I thought I was. And can you see the parallel spiritually? Perfect illustration. Made me to see that I was not really what I thought I was. Began to question myself, began to ask myself, who am I? And those other big questions of life came to my mind. What's the purpose of life? Why am I here? Is there a God? Question number two, or really same question said a different way. I started off with, who am I? A question that I began to ask myself deeply at the age of 16. Point number two, I am who? I am who? Finding out the truth to that question. So if God alone is the only one who knows man correctly, according to Jeremiah 17 and verse 9, then only he can reveal that to somebody, as I've said. And God says in that verse in Jeremiah that I'm a deceitful and desperately wicked person. My heart, my real me, is deceitful and desperately wicked. I could turn you to other statements in the Bible if you don't believe me. Romans 3 and 23. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so, as I began to ponder this question and search for the answer and get to the Bible, and believe me, I started to read the Bible earnestly. A bit like Martin Luther. I want the answer. Where is the answer? And as I began to search, this was the answer that was coming out. You have fallen short of the glory or the standard of God. Oh, God sets a standard for mankind. You want to have fellowship with me, says God? You want to know me, says God? Then you have to have this impeccable standard. Only those who have this impeccable standard can approach me. You fall short. For the boys and girls here, think of the arrow. Think of the archer. Think of that arrow not even hitting the target. God demands a bullseye. Perfect,
perfect bullseye, and you don't even get to the target. You're light years away from the target. You don't reach the standard. You're a condemned person. And this was who I was discovering myself to be. And these truths, I have to say, were hard to swallow when I first became aware of them. A fallen sinner. I am who? You're a depraved and fallen sinner. Now, I had felt guilt and shame as a little boy. I'm sure you've all felt guilt and shame. I hope you all would admit that. But when I was younger, I think it was a very fleeting and momentary thing. But when age 16 came, there was a prolonged and permanent sense of corruption and depravity began to grip my heart. And I remember, interestingly enough, I was in the school that I used to go to in Lisburn as a teenager. I had the privilege of just being down there the other day to watch a young fella from Ballyclare play rugby. And I was able to walk up through the school, and that part of the building's still there. And I remember the very spot. I was coming down the stairs, and I'd just been given an English essay by my English teacher. And there was red pen slashed through it. And at the bottom, in bold red ink, "Don't you ever hand me in such rubbish again." And I think in my own memory, that's the first time I really began to feel the sting and the shame and the guilt of sin. This was an English teacher who I knew was not a Christian man. And he was telling me that the content of my essay was garbage. It was full of explicatives. It was full of rubbish. And he was telling me, "Don't ever write anything like that again." And I can trace the beginning of God's work by his Spirit, as far as my perception is concerned, to that point. And like Pilgrim in the Pilgrim's Progress, I began to have this heavy weight upon my soul that seemed to keep weighing me down, and I couldn't get rid of it, and it didn't fleet away. It lingered and it lingered and it lingered. I began to get convicted about aspects of my behavior being morally wrong. I wanted to stop. I wanted to change, and yet I seemed incapable of doing so. I was reading the Bible. I was reading the daily bread notes. I was praying in secret in my bedroom. I was searching for relief and answers to this weight and this burden. I even began attending church, this church. Some of you will remember the time when the new building was completed, and it was at that time, 1990, the advertisement was seen by my sister, and God used her, just like God used some of you here, and God used her to plant that seed and said, "Why don't you go to church with Mum up there in Hillsborough? Why don't you take your mum to church?" I had just been absent, let's say, for a few years. And she didn't know, because I didn't tell anybody what was going on inside my heart. But she said, and I went and I took Mum and I began to come here. I began to come to the youth fellowship, and some of the folks here knew that. I began to attend. I was hungry. I began to listen to Brother Barnes' sermons. Very thankful for young people. Young people. Can I say that to anybody here who's in the youth fellowship? I was very thankful for young people who made me welcome as a stranger in that big auditorium. For young people who sought me out and sat beside me and say, "Will you stay for the supper?" I was a stranger. I knew nobody. Please, young people, you don't understand the value that these things can be in the economy of God. And I stayed for supper, and I was made welcome and felt welcome at the youth fellowship. And you might say, why did you keep coming back to a place that you kept hearing such bad news about your sinnership, about your guilt before God, about your failure to meet God's standards? What compelled you to keep coming back and listening to that? Well, simple answer. I am who? Yes, I'm a sinner. Yes, I'm a guilty wretch. Yes, I deserve hellfire. But here's something else I was being taught by the preaching of God's word. Not only are you a sinner, but you're a subject of God's affections. What? I am who? You! You sinner! You're a subject of God's affections, of God's love, of God's matchless love, an object of his affection. He was targeting me. He had targeted me with his divine passion, and he provided his own son as my punishment, bearing my sacrifice. God so loved the world of sinners just like me, the Bible said, that he gave his only begotten son. And just as Moses said to God, who am I, when God called him to serve in Egypt? And just as David said, who am I, when God said, your generation and those who come from you, there's going to be a Messiah? And just as Mephibosheth said when he got to the king's table, who am I to deserve this? To deserve this privilege and elevation and banquet? I'm just a dead dog. I can't believe this. I am who? The songwriter put it well. Who am I that the king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, but thine, Lord? The answer I may never know. Why he ever loved me so, that at an old rugged cross he'd go. For who am I? I am who? Yes, I found out the answer to my question was that I was a sinner, but I also found out that I was loved by God. Last and final twist on the words. Who I am. Who I am as I stand before you today, believing the truth and having certainty about my identity in Jesus Christ. Who I am? I'll tell you who I am. I'm a forgiven soul. I'm a saved sinner. I'm a child of the King of Kings. I'm a forever loved member of God's family. I'm a recipient of God's mercy in Christ. I'm a possessor of eternal life. I'm a beneficiary of his atoning death. And I'm an acquitted criminal by God my judge. That's who I am. That's who all the Christians here are. Now, can you say that with absolute certainty about yourself? How do you know? How do I know? How can I have such certainty? Is it just because somehow I feel rather, you know, on top of things today? Of course not. The certainty comes from the Word. And when did this transformation in my thinking take place? This transformation from the young man at 19 years of age who was weeping, who was crying, who had no peace, who couldn't sleep, to someone who's making such a bold and assertive statement before you tonight. Well, it took place at my conversion in this hall. That's when it took place. There was the mission, February 1990, winter time. It was a cold night. I'd been in the mission on the Monday night. It seemed to me, in my recollection, as I thought and considered, it seemed to me the Spirit of God saying, you've got to get this sorted. There was just this urgency. I need to get this sorted or I am going to crack up. What is the solution to this? I've been listening to Mr. Barnes for maybe 6 to 8 months. The conviction was mounting. I'd been in the youth fellowship, Harold McKibben, listening to all that teaching. And it just was coming to a peak. And I went on Monday night and I sat approximately second row in from the back there. And as soon as it was amen and benediction and there was a supper provided, not as sumptuous as the supper that Brother Kenny was talking about earlier. We supper. I started to chat. Took cold feet. Went away. Couldn't sleep. University that day down in Jordanstown. Couldn't think of anything else. Got home. Dad, can I borrow the car? Had no car of my own. I was 19 years of age. Borrowed my dad's car. Dad was a driving instructor. Some of you know that. Sorry, son. Busy tonight. Full schedule. I said, no, you've got to have so. I said, would you leave me? He says, I don't have time to leave you. He says, could you even leave me close? Am I giving you some impression about
the work of grace in my heart. I got left off in the middle of Hillsborough. I walked all the way up here and to the church. I was 2 hours early for the meeting. I spent 2 hours right back here at the fire exit, looking up into the starry sky and saying, "Oh God, if you are really there, please answer my questions." I was 19 and I desperately wanted to know. Meeting started, I came in. This time I sat on the edge. And this time when the meeting was over, can't remember a thing Joe preached, made a bolt for the toilets, ran into the cubicles. A 19-year-old boy, rugby captain at school, reduced to just jelly. "Oh God, oh God, hear my prayer." Remember coming through those doors, God had Joe Peden sitting right here starting his supper. And I just made a beeline for him. I said, "I'm not going to talk to anybody. I don't want to get distracted." I said, "Joe, I've got to talk to you." And he knew. He said, "Come on ahead." Went into the wee prayer room there. And what I do remember is this passage of scripture. Romans 10:13. I've read it in your hearing. "Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved." And the conversation at that point went something like this. "David, do you think God tells lies?" "No, not a chance." "That's right. You believe the Bible's true?" "Absolutely, every word of it." "Amen." "Well, you see here it says that whoever," well, that includes you. That's all inclusive. You can put your own name in there. "David Wilson, if he calls on the name of the Lord, he shall be saved." And he emphasized the "shall." And young people and men and women, that was it. That was lights on. That was my Reformation moment. Oh yes, I'd prayed. I had thought it was to do with me. I wasn't repentant enough. Somehow there wasn't enough emotion. Somehow there wasn't enough dread. Somehow there wasn't enough fear of God. And I was always looking inward. And suddenly the lights came on. It's not about what I'm doing. It's what Christ has done. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord, the name that encapsulates all that Christ is, whoever calls shall, absolute certainty. He said, "Do you believe it?" I said, "I do." He said, "Do you want to pray?" I said, "I do." He said, "Now," and he led it straight before me. God doesn't pull any punches. God doesn't hide. This is not going to be easy. Christianity is no rose bed. No life of rose. It's no easy pathway. Christ has told us that we must through much tribulation enter the kingdom of God. Men and women, I didn't care. The grace of God enabled me not to care. I wanted it, men and women. Is there anybody here tonight? And you're in the position I was in 34 years ago, sitting somewhere in this hall. And you desperately, by the grace of God, you want the salvation of God. You want the peace of God that's priceless and beyond price. Well, that was me. I came out. I prayed. I knew I was converted. I knew that God's word made it certain, not my efforts. And my trust was all in Christ. Christ has done all the work. I came out. I had no lift home. The snow had started to come on. And I scrounged a lift from Mark. Where is he? There. And I scrounged, you remember that? I scrounged a lift from, it was an old Escort, was it? An old banger of a car. And I was out there and the snow was starting to come on. I didn't care. I would have waded through feet of snow. And Mark says to me, Joe said, "Go and start talking to people. Go and tell them." And I think Mark was probably the first one that got hit with this wave. "Mark, I've just got saved." And he looked at me and said, "I thought you were saved." You see, now don't, that's not his fault. That's me. I was a good bluffer. Young person, are you like me? I was in the youth fellowship. I was singing. Never would have made it into the Kingdom Heirs, but I was singing. I was singing away. I knew this is what I should be doing. This is good praise to God. But I was bluffing. I was bluffing men and women. I was bluffing young people. But now I had the true song in my heart. And I went out skipping and joyful and straight home, told my parents, and the folks here, thank you so much, as a young Christian, encouraging me in the prayer meeting, trying to pray, stumbling with my words, getting involved in the Sunday school, getting involved in the outreach, Eric Spence and all those guys down in the old people's homes down there where my granny used to be, and just getting into the thick of it and learning as I went along, and thank you for all the patience that you had with me. And so here I stand today, with the help of God, I continue to this day.
And I trust that if I've struck a chord with anybody tonight, oh, as Rutherford said, my heaven would be two heavens if I could stand here where Joe stood and somebody here would walk up to me and say, will you talk to me? Joe Peden, a couple of years after that, wrote a testimony book. I'm the 19-year-old that he mentions at the very end that stood before him and wept tears of joy and knew the salvation of God. The Lord bless his word. The Lord bless his word. And if you're here tonight and you're not saved, please, please don't be like me. Don't be like me and come and maybe you've been already this week. Brother prayed, been and gone, not saved. That was me. But God was merciful to my soul. God gave me another chance. Please take this opportunity that God has given you. Do you want me to close in prayer, brother? You come on ahead.
Well, we have a closing hymn this evening. It's the hymn numbered 7. And as we come to this hymn, I want to thank our brother for coming along tonight and bringing that very sincere and faithful word of testimony. That verse, Romans 10, verse 13, that was the verse the Lord used to speak to my heart the night that I got saved. And we put the Lord to the test, called upon his name. The Lord was true to his word, and the Lord saved my soul. And so if there's one tonight and your heart is troubled and you would like that matter settled, don't go away tonight. But while we're having a cup of tea and a bite to eat, you seek out Mr. Wilson or speak to another believer that you know and get the matter settled. Get it settled for all eternity. To God be the glory. Great things he hath done, so loved he the world that he gave us his Son.
Rejoice, O come to the Father.
just bowing together in a closing word of prayer. Our gracious and our loving Heavenly Father, we do praise Thee for this meeting tonight. We thank Thee, our Father, for Thy presence with us and for help that has been given to each one that has taken part. And we thank Thee, O God, for the faithful word of testimony. And we thank Thee for the salvation that has been purchased and provided for by the Saviour. And we would ask, O God, that even tonight Thou would speak to some heart in this meeting. And, O Lord, give them that same grace. Draw them by Thine irresistible grace. And may they close in with the Lord Jesus Christ even this night. Receive of our thanks for the good things provided. Do bless them to our bodily use. And help us each one to eat and drink to Thy glory. We ask these things for Jesus' sake. Amen. You take your seats, please don't go away tonight unless you really have to, but do stay for a cup of tea and a burger.